Isambard Kingdom Brunel was born in 1806, yet he has helped shape the new world. Because of him, we have advanced railways, iconic bridges, and pioneering ships that have transformed modern engineering. While he studied at a prestigious secondary school in France, specializing in math and science, his best education came from his father. Marc Brunel became the most prominent engineer in Britain and taught his only son the ropes. But Marc was terrible with money, sinking sums into inventions with no financial return. He was even arrested for debt and spent a humiliating 10 weeks in prison. The most famous project of the father-son duo was constructing the Thames Tunnel in London, aimed at connecting the north and south banks to ease the traffic bottleneck of London Bridge. But digging a tunnel through soft ground was dangerous. Previous attempts had ended in disaster, with tunnels collapsing and flooding. Marc Brunel's innovative idea of using a tunneling shield, inspired by how shipworms tunneled through wood without causing the surrounding area to collapse, laid the groundwork for modern tunnel boring machines. Before work began on the Thames, Marc fell ill and handed over the reins to his teenage son. Isambard oversaw the challenging task, where workers frequently fainted and vomited due to poor ventilation and the foul smell. Isambard nearly drowned when he was carried away unconscious by a wave and had to be rescued by an engineer. After 2 decades of work, which included years of pausing the project due to financial difficulties, the Thames Tunnel was completed in 1843. It was the world's first tunnel to be driven beneath a major body of water. Isambard had high ambitions for his future, but worried a great deal. When his father was trying to build a gas engine, he expressed in his diary, "How much more likely it is that all this will turn out to nothing, that I should pass through life as most people, and that I should gradually forget my castles in the air, live in a small house, and at most, keep my gig. My father may die, or the tunnel may fail, and I most likely, in such circumstances, cut my throat or hang myself." While the tunnel project was on hold, Isambard moved to Bristol, a major port city, in search of work. Although 2 railway companies rejected his application as an engineer, Brunel's design for a new bridge was selected. The Clifton Suspension Bridge was originally designed to accommodate horse-drawn carriages and pedestrians, yet it still meets the demands of modern times. Today, it accommodates 12,000 cars and trucks daily, a testament to Brunel's vision. Brunel's greatest project in Bristol was building a new railway to attract more business and facilitate the easier movement of goods to and from London. Reflecting on the significance of railways, Stephen Brindle, the author of Brunel, The Man Who Built the World, wrote, "Today, we rather take railways for granted, noticing them most when they go wrong. They seem like part of the landscape, and it requires an effort of imagination to grasp what a vast cultural and economic achievement they represented when they were new, and what they meant to the people who built them." Brunel chose a route from Bristol to London that was criticized for passing through less populated areas. However, it was brilliant because it avoided steep hills and sharp curves, earning the nickname Brunel's Billiard Table for its smoothness. This design enabled higher speeds and more efficient travel by surpassing the hilly and winding routes of his competitors. Brunel's ambition was to create a railway the world had never seen before, writing in his diary, "The time is not far off when we shall be able to take our coffee and write while going noiselessly and smoothly at 45 miles per hour. Let me try." His innovative thinking extended to the width of the track's gauges. He questioned the widely accepted standard gauge of 4 feet, 8.5 inches, which was based on historic precedent from early colliery tramways. Applying first principles thinking, he broke down the problem into its most basic elements and recognized that a broader gauge of 7 feet and 1/4 inch would accommodate larger wheels, providing greater stability and comfort at higher speeds. However, the coexistence of broad and standard gauges caused inefficiencies. Ultimately, the Gauge Act of 1846 standardized gauges across the country to the smaller size. But Brunel's questioning of established assumptions had a lasting impact on engineering. Innovators like Elon Musk employ first principles to rethink the manufacturing process of building reusable rockets, reducing the cost of space travel. With a stable income of £2,000 annually from his work on the Great Western Railway, Brunel can now think about his future. He married Mary Horsley, whose father William was a prominent composer. He didn't think he'd be a good partner, writing in his diary, "Shall I make a good husband? Am doubtful." My ambition, or whatever it may be called, is rather extensive. Brunel's ambition extended beyond the railways. The expansion of the Great Western Railway involved an unprecedented amount of bridge building. He emphasized the importance of structural integrity and load distribution, writing to his assistant William Bell, whether of iron, wood, or masonry, take care that the surface of the base should be proportioned that the strain should pass through the center of it. One of Brunel's most iconic bridges is the Maidenhead Railway Bridge, notable for having the widest and flattest brick arches in Britain, if not the world. The flat design was intended to keep the railway line as level as possible. While furiously working away on bridges and railways, he still had time to think about ships. At the time, it was thought that steamships couldn't carry enough coal to cross the Atlantic. The belief was the bigger the ship, the greater amount of fuel needed. But Brunel realized this assumption was wrong. The key was optimizing the ship's design to reduce water resistance. By focusing on the shape and surface area of the hull, he demonstrated that larger ships could move more efficiently and require less coal than previously thought. Over 230 feet long, with a displacement of 2,300 tons, the SS Great Western was the largest ship of its time. She made her maiden voyage from Bristol to New York City in April 1838. Brunel nearly never lived to see the day. The week before, a fire broke out in the engine room. Brunel, always the hands-on engineer, rushed down a ladder to investigate. He stepped on a burnt rung, lost his footing, and fell 20 feet onto the flooded engine room floor. He landed on top of his friend, who thankfully wasn't injured, and managed to save an unconscious Brunel from drowning. Undeterred by his near-death experience, Brunel was already envisioning his next great ship. The SS Great Britain was the first large ship built with an iron hull instead of the traditional wooden hull, which provided greater strength and durability. Brunel built the Great Britain during the most stressful phase of the Great Western Railway. He managed this by working 20 hours a day, and sometimes only had time for a nap in an armchair. The pressure proved to be too much for the Great Britain's engine designer. Francis Humphreys originally conceived of a large paddle wheel engine like the one on this boat, but Brunel was convinced that a screw propeller would improve the ship's efficiency and speed while reducing fuel consumption. Humphreys died during the ship's construction, with his friend, engineer James Naismith, describing his demise this way. The labor and the anxiety which he had already undergone, and perhaps the disappointment of his hopes, proved too much for him, and a brain fever carried him off after a few days' illness. Brunel and his team paused work for 2 years to develop their screw propeller. It was so advanced that modern-day propellers are only around 5% more efficient. At 322 feet in length, with a displacement of 3,675 tons, the Great Britain was the largest and most advanced ship ever built. With her iron hull, the largest engines ever at the time, and screw propeller, author Stephen Brindle remarked, "She is arguably the single most important vessel in terms of ship design in history." And yet, Brunel wanted to outdo himself once again. He envisioned a ship many times larger than the Great Britain, the Great Eastern, measuring 692 feet in length with a displacement of 32,000 tons, was 9 times greater than that of the Great Britain. Designed to carry 4,000 passengers around the world, Brunel wanted the Great Eastern to be able to travel to India or Australia without refueling at coaling stations. The ship featured both a single-screw propeller and paddle wheels, providing versatility and remarkable maneuverability. As Stephen Brindle put it, she was an engineering dream, a triumph of design over function, of ambition over common sense even. Brunel was perhaps the only man in the world who could have imagined such a ship, designed her in detail and brought her into being. She was his ultimate triumph and his greatest folly. Historians believe the stress of completing and launching the Great Eastern led to Brunel's death. Although he had estimated it would cost £500,000 to build, the engineer John Scott Russell's company agreed to build it for only £377,000. But this was a gross underestimate. The ship cost £600,000 in counting, not including the hundreds of thousands to install the engines or the launch, not to mention no port in the world could cope with a ship that size. Then Scott Russell's company went bankrupt, forcing Brunel to work without a salary and pay his assistants out of pocket. The Eastern Steam Navigation Company, heavily invested in by Brunel, took over the ship's construction but also went bankrupt. The Great Ship Company bought the incomplete ship for a significantly reduced price of £160,000. John Scott Russell managed to revive his business and won the contract to resume work on the ship. Brunel poured every last drop of his energy into the greatest ship the world knew. This photograph of him in front of the launching chains reveals mud on his trousers, a testament to his hands-on approach. Brunel was too ill to attend the maiden voyage on September 7, 1859, which was itself a disaster. As the ship passed the south coast of England 2 days later, a heater attached to the paddle engine boilers exploded, killing several crew members. Although the ship wasn't badly damaged, the incident deeply affected Brunel. Already suffering from kidney problems, Brunel, a lifelong heavy smoker, was heartbroken, and his health worsened rapidly. A few days after the explosion, on September 15, 1859, Brunel passed away at the age of 53. The Great Eastern never did live up to its name of traveling to the Far East. It was sold to a telegraph cable laying company and helped lay two telegraph cables under the Atlantic Ocean connecting Europe and America. But it was eventually replaced by the C.S. Faraday, a ship specifically built for laying cables. Once obsolete, the Great Eastern was repurposed as a billboard before being demolished. It took 2 years and 200 men to cut it into pieces, a testament to its robust construction. As Brindle put it, from almost every point of view, the ship was too big, too far ahead of her time. Brunel built the industrial world, yet he never realized his dream of building his castle in the sky, his own retirement home. He had planned to do so and bought a plot of land in the seaside English town of Torquay in Devon, but never lived to see it completed. Brunel's legacy was carried on by his son Henry, who showed the greatest interest in engineering out of his three children and later became the structural engineer for London's Tower Bridge. Isambard Kingdom Brunel's legacy is evident not just in the structures he built, but because he dared to dream bigger dreams than anyone else of his time. His friend and colleague Daniel Gooch captured his essence perfectly. By his death, the greatest of England's engineers was lost. The man of the greatest originality of thought and power of execution, bold in his plans but right. The commercial world thought him extravagant, but although he was so, great things are not done by those who sit down and count the cost of every thought and act. Brunel worked so hard because he wanted absolute control over all aspects of his projects, using mathematics and his engineering intuition to achieve greatness. If you're inspired by Brunel and want to improve your skills in math, science, and engineering, I highly recommend Brilliant. Brilliant is a website and app where you can learn STEM interactively, and it's free for you to try out. Brilliant recently launched a ton of new data content that uses real-world data to train you to see trends and make better informed decisions. Their programming courses are an excellent way to build foundational skills. You can start programming in Python on day one with their intuitive built-in drag-and-drop editor. One of my favorite courses is How LLMs Work, where you get hands-on experience with real language models to explore how they build vocabulary and choose their next word. You can try Brilliant for free for 30 days by clicking my custom link in the description, brilliant.org/newsthink, or scanning the QR code on your screen. If you sign up with my link or code, you'll get a 20% discount on Brilliant's annual premium subscription, which gives you unlimited access to their thousands of interactive offerings. Thanks for watching. For Newsthink, I'm Cindy Pom.